Turn in your Bibles, please, to Isaiah chapter 55. As you may or may not know, I like to play golf. You probably know that by now. And this week is the Masters Golf Tournament. It is one of the great golf tournaments in the season. And millions of people are watching that tournament. But I believe that God's eyes are here, not at Augusta, Georgia, on his people, proclaiming and hearing God's word. So we're at a better place than Augusta, Georgia, right now this morning. Isaiah chapter 55, a great chapter. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good, and delight yourself in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear that your soul may live, and I'll make you an everlasting covenant. My steadfast, sure love for David. Behold, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and a commander for the peoples. Behold, you shall call a nation that you did not know, and a nation that did not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God and of the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord, return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, making it spring forth, and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I had purposed, and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. And the mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your amazing word. Might it run deeply into our hearts? Might we pay attention to it and rejoice in it? And apply it to our lives, for it's in your name we pray, amen. Isaiah 55 is a fantastic chapter in that God is inviting all peoples to come and enjoy his salvation. But Isaiah 55 is not just for the seeker, it is also for the believer. As we read earlier there in Psalm chapter 40, verse 16, may all who love your salvation say continually, the Lord is great. And so Isaiah 55 is for the seeker and the saint, for the seeker that they might consider the marvels of God's salvation, and for the saint it reminds us of what God has done for us. And in reminding us what God has done for us, might we be saying, great is our Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this fantastic salvation that you have given to us. So Isaiah 55 starts out with a great invitation. This is what theologians call a general invitation to all peoples throughout all of history. Come and be satisfied in God. But you know, few people respond to this marvelous invitation. It's not just me that has said that, Jesus did. He said, the way is wide to destruction, and many people take that path. The way to life is narrow, and few shall find it. Why is it that so many people do not respond to this marvelous invitation that God provides here in Isaiah chapter 55? Now, I think the answer is this. It is because mankind is pursuing the passing pleasures of sin. Now, I don't mean, you might be thinking to yourself, I'm not talking about some gross immorality, drunkenness and drugs and so forth. The passing pleasures of sin can be just simply misplaced priorities. Misplaced priorities. And in pursuing the passing pleasures of sin, a person is never going to be truly satisfied. If you don't believe that, you can turn to the book of Ecclesiastes someday. And there, King Solomon, who has everything at his disposal to be able to do anything he could ever think or imagine. I mean, you know, a month ago when the lottery was $1.5 billion, I did not rush out and buy a lottery ticket, by the way. But your head begins to think, you know, what if I were to win $1.5 billion? Well, half of that is taken in taxes. And if you were to win it, 10% goes to your pastor. So that leaves you... it leaves you with a little bit of change left. But, you know, you begin to think to yourself, what would I do with like a half a billion dollars? I could do a lot of things. And that's what Solomon had the privilege to be able to do. The coffers, the taxes that came into his coffers every year were tens of millions of dollars. And so he had all of this money to do with whatever he would. And he decided that I'm going to pursue whatever my mind sets it to. And so he builds a fantastic palace for us. It would be our house that beyond our wildest imagination. He built fabulous looking gardens. Had chariots and horses. For us today would be any type of car that we could ever want or imagine, and a lot of them. He had a number of wives and concubines, and so he pursued that angle as well. He pursued knowledge, and so he's pursuing everything that you would think would bring you happiness. And yet, at the end of the day, he could have sung this song by the Rolling Stones. I can't get no satisfaction. I remember hearing that for the first time in the late 60s. It ages me. I thought, I love the melody. I can't get no satisfaction. But I try, and I try. I know, you're saying, stop, please. I heard all I need. And you know, I actually really like the lyrics as well. Isn't it interesting how unsaved people can identify problems so well? In fact, sometimes they can identify problems even better than Christians can. I can't get no satisfaction. Here's a rocker who has all the money in the world as well to get whatever they want, but can't find any satisfaction. But I keep trying and trying and trying. You know, somebody has said the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over, expecting different results. You know, that song is actually timeless because it's so true. Solomon, centuries before that, came to the same conclusion. I am doing all of these things to try to find some satisfaction in the passing pleasures of sin, some bad, some good, and I find no satisfaction. Everything is empty. It's empty at the end of the day. Keep trying. You'll never find satisfaction in the passing pleasures of sin. Never, ever. Do you know why? Augustine, the great saint in the 5th century, said it this way, very succinctly. God has created us for himself, and until our hearts find our home in God, we will never, ever be satisfied, no matter how many times, no matter how much we try. And so that is what God is saying here. This is a great invitation. Come and be satisfied. You see, most people think if I turn my life to God as a ball and a chain. No, says God, if you turn to me, you will be satisfied. And he uses a couple of metaphors here. One has to do with food, one has to do with water. You know, in the New Testament, Jesus Christ performs a miracle and he multiplies the fishes and the loaves, and there are at least 5,000 men there to receive it, plus women, plus children. So many Bible scholars believe that there were as many as 25,000 people whom Jesus fed with just a few fish and a few loaves. Obviously, it was a fantastic miracle. And so this banqueting table, and so the next day, here comes all 25,000 people, and they are following Jesus. You know, if I had been Jesus, I'm going, wow, I'm going to write a book about this. I'm pastor of a mega church, but Jesus says this, the reason that you are following me is not because you're really seeking eternal things. You just want another meal. He says, why don't you work for the bread that gives you eternal life? Okay. What type of bread can give me eternal life? Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He who eats of me will have eternal life. Most of them, by the way, turned aside, don't want that. But that is what Jesus Christ is offering. I am the bread of life. Accept me. Work for that which gives you eternal life, not the bread that you eat daily, that we all do eat daily, that we're going to die. But by accepting Christ, we can have eternal life and be satisfied. And he also uses another metaphor here, and that is of water. Drink of the water that is unto eternal life. In, I think, John chapter 7, Jesus Christ says, he who believes in me, wells of water will spring up in their soul. It always makes me think of a place we visited when our kids were little. It was in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. And some of you I know who are from Michigan would probably know about this. The Upper Peninsula, and in the Upper Peninsula, there's what is called the Big Springs. It's a springs the size of our parking lot. It's about the size of a football field. And it is 40 feet deep, and it is absolutely crystal clear. And you can take a boat out there, and there's a glass-bottom boat, and you can look down 40 feet, and the water is absolutely crystal clear, and you can see the springs churning up through the sand. And if my memory serves me right, I think it's 10,000 gallons a minute that is coming up out of that springs. It's an interesting place. Now, if you contrast that with the four corners of the United States, at our prior church, we did mission trips out to the Navajo Indians who lived in Arizona and New Mexico. And so we were out there several different times, and we traveled through the Four Corners area. And I don't know if you've ever been in the Four Corners area, but there's a stretch in the Four Corners area that is absolutely barren. There is no cactuses, cacti, is that what it is? No bushes, no green of any sort. It looks like the surface of the moon. Now, if you were looking for water, would you go to the Four Corners area or to the Upper Peninsula of Michigan? Well, it's a no-brainer. Yes. Yeah, even Rick Opel could figure that out. I wouldn't go to the Four Corners area. I would go to the Upper Peninsula of Michigan because there you have all the water that you could possibly imagine for the rest of your life. You know, and in the same way, why is it, says God, do you pursue something when you're looking for water that springs up? Why would you look in something that cannot possibly satisfy? Why don't you turn to me and have these wells of springs flowing through your body for eternity? It makes absolute sense. See, what a wonderful invitation this is from God to be able to satisfy the craving of our soul as found in the person of Christ. And then he goes on and he says, by the way, when he says in verse 3, incline your ear and come to me, the point is that these two metaphors are pointing to God. And if you go to the New Testament, it's pointing to the person of Jesus Christ. And he goes on and he says, and it's absolutely free. This wonderful salvation, you don't have to buy it, don't have to pay for it, don't have to work for it. But you know, once again, most people in the world want to work for this salvation. They work for it. It's like, you don't have to. It's, again, it's absolutely free. If you want to work for your salvation, it is what the Bible calls your righteousness. And your righteousness, you know what the payment is for your righteousness? It's the same as the payment for the passing pleasures of sin. It's death. Most people would not believe that at all. They would say if you're pursuing the passing pleasures of sin, well, I understand that you might possibly be punished for all eternity. But if I am pursuing my righteousness, certainly God isn't going to punish me for that, is he? And the answer is yes. Because all of our righteousness, as the prophet would say, is as filthy rags. And so that if we want the wages for our self-righteousness, says the Bible, the wages for that is the same as the passing pleasures of sin. That is eternal damnation. So why not just receive it for free? I don't know how the Bible can make it much clearer than that. In the New Testament, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, for it says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, not of works, so that no one can boast before a holy God. God says to you and to me, you can't do it, but my son Jesus Christ can do it for you. Will you trust in him? See? I got special effects this morning. So in verse 6 it says this, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. You know, I like what R.C. Sproul has said. Most people believe in justification by death. That is, they wait until they die, hoping that God will forgive them at that particular time. But in the book of Hebrews, it says that it is appointed unto men to die once, and after this comes not salvation, but judgment, if you have never trusted Jesus Christ. And so you don't wait until you die. You trust in God now. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, whether that is the passing pleasures of sin or whether that is your own self-righteousness. And the unrighteous man, his thoughts, let him return to the Lord that he may have compassion on him. Once again, this wonderful invitation that God gives to all men. But again, the problem here is that many people do not want to confess the fact that they are sinners. I'm not as bad as the person who's in a state penitentiary. I don't need that salvation. I'm doing pretty good on my own. But you know, when it comes to traffic laws, has anybody here obeyed all of the traffic laws? Yeah, no takers. That's good. I had a friend once who said, you know, you should never go over the speed limit. And I said, yes, that's true, because if you get caught, you're going to have to pay for it. And I said, do you go over the speed limit? And he goes, no, I don't go over the speed limit. Famous last words. Less than a month later, he got picked up for, guess what? Speeding. We can't even obey traffic laws. None of us have done that perfectly. We all know it if you do any type of commuting, because we see other people doing it, breaking the law. Going through a red light, what's up with that? But we're all moral lawbreakers. The Bible calls it lawlessness. You know, there's a young man one day comes up to Jesus, and he says to Jesus, good teacher, how can I have eternal life? Jesus said, there is nobody good except God. By the way, he never addresses him again as good. He doesn't really believe that Jesus is God. But Jesus said, okay, if you want to inherit eternal life, this is what you need to do. Don't steal, don't commit adultery, and so forth. He named, I think, 5 of the 10 commandments. And the young man said, I've done them all. Wow. Jesus is amazed. Wow. I never thought that was possible. Oh, one more thing. Go sell all of your possessions and come and follow me. And the rich young ruler says, I can't do that. Can't do that. He broke at least 2 commandments by that response. Do you know what they are? Commandment number 1 is to love the Lord your God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength. The 2nd, the 10th commandment is that you shall not covet. He did both. He put money ahead of God. And so what Jesus was trying to point out to this rich young ruler is that you are a moral lawbreaker. And because you are a moral lawbreaker, you are a sinner in danger of eternal damnation. The disciples said, if a rich person can't get saved, how can anybody get saved? Glad you asked. What is impossible with man is possible by God. By turning your life to Jesus Christ, God can do the impossible. Save even rich people, poor people, blind people, or on and on, etc. So the point here is this, is that what usually prevents a person from enjoying this salvation is that they refuse to acknowledge the fact that they are a sinner. Once you acknowledge that you are a sinner in danger of eternal damnation, it is now just a short hop to the cross. Because now a person asks, what must I do? Again, glad you asked. It is the cross of Jesus Christ. And he continues on here and he says this, my ways are not your ways, said God. You know, man tries by himself with his own mind to try to figure out the ways of God. And he always ends up going in the opposite direction. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The cross is the wisdom of God. To the natural man, it is foolishness that I should have to submit my life to a guy who lived 2,000 years ago that you said raised from the grave? Baloney. I'd rather trust my own. God says, don't do that. My ways are far above your ways. Don't think naturally, think biblically. Man can never know the mind of God starting with his own mind. He always ends up going in the opposite direction. The only way that we can know God is if God communicates to us. And he has. He has given us his word so that we might know his thoughts, especially in regards to salvation. And God says, my word will accomplish that for which I have sent it. Just as the rain comes and waters the fields so that things might grow, so says the word of God, comes down from heaven, revelation from God that God communicates to us, and his word causes us to grow in salvation if we receive it. But if we reject it, his word will also accomplish his purposes by judging and revealing to persons their condemnation and their need for a Savior. The only way that you can understand and know the gospel is in the Word of God, not through human intellect. But those who have turned to Lord Jesus Christ and have trusted him, not only are they satisfied, but as he said earlier, I'll make a covenant with you. Not like the covenant that I made with the children of Israel when they came out of the land of Egypt. It is called the Old Covenant. It is sometimes called the Mosaic Covenant. It was never intended to save the people. The Mosaic Covenant was a covenant of possession. If you obey my commandments, you will possess the promised land. But the Old Covenant was, again, not a covenant of salvation, but a covenant of possession. But in the New Testament, when we trust Christ as our personal Savior, we are entered into a new covenant with the Lord Jesus Christ. We say this every time we do the Lord's Supper. In the book of Matthew, Jesus said, I'm breaking my body, I'm pouring out my blood in the new covenant that he has now ratified. The new covenant is a covenant of salvation that actually began in the Old Testament with the Abrahamic covenant. And in this new covenant, what happens is that we are regenerated. We are made alive. God wipes out our sins, forgives us, and loves us for eternity. So that this covenant isn't conditional. It is unconditional. It is based upon the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ and his love for his redeemed. Another aspect of this new covenant, as he points out here in this text, is the Davidic covenant, which is also part of the new covenant, but the Davidic covenant is more specific, where God promised to David that he would eventually have a descendant sitting upon the throne, and that descendant would be the Lord Jesus Christ, Isaiah chapter 9. And he would reign and rule upon this earth. The greatness of this is that when Christ returns for a second time, he will come not as a suffering lamb, but as a conquering king. And he will dispense of his enemies. And we will reign and rule with him. Now, I don't know about you, but I would be just happy just to sit and watch him reign and rule. But apparently, the Davidic covenant will bring to completion what God had intended for man from the very beginning, that man was to rule under the authority of God, rule over this earth. And when Christ comes back a second time, we will reign and rule under his authority as he sets up his kingdom here on earth. And so there is a fantastic future in store for us. Not only satisfaction now and enjoying our God, but in the future as well. And he also finally mentions this, is that we're going to be led forth with joy instead of thorns and thistles. Eventually, Christ is going to come back and restore this creation. Romans chapter 8, now it is under the curse of the sin. But then when Christ comes back, it'll be restored, and all of creation, it will seem like, is shouting out the glories of God. It does that now, Psalm 19, but even more so then. I hope I'm not being sacrilegious, but it sort of makes me think of Walt Disney animated movies where the animals and trees and everything is just in harmony with mankind. I sort of think of that with the restoration, where Isaiah actually does talk about the wolf and the lamb lying down together and creation shouting out the glorious salvation of God. Again, that we experience now, but to a greater degree when Christ comes back a second time. You know, Martin Luther, as he was struggling to find salvation, and when he finally it clicked in his mind, he writes, "It was as if heaven had opened its doors and God smiling down his amazing love, his great salvation." If you were a seeker here this morning, never heard this before, God would challenge you to this wonderful, great invitation. Why not accept what Christ has done for you upon the cross and finally find what you have been created for? You have been created to be one with the Lord Jesus Christ. You will be satisfied. And you have a fantastic future beyond that here. But those of us, most of us, I would assume here this morning, we know the Lord Jesus Christ. As it says in Psalm 40, "Let those who seek after the Lord be joyous and glad. Let those who love thy salvation." Do you love your salvation? Then say, "Great is the Lord."
Great is the Lord.
Amen. I didn't really ask you to do that, but you did it anyway. That's fantastic. You know, I think so many times we as believers just sort of assume our salvation. And we start out too many times every day always saying, "God, what do you want me to do?" Rather than starting out the day with Psalm 40, verse 16, "Let those who love thy salvation say, great is the Lord." The first thing that God wants every believer every day to say, "Lord, thank you for your amazing salvation, and you are great. I love you for it. Now, what do you want me to do?" Now we do it in the power of the Spirit rather than in our own flesh. God loves it. He loves it when his people love his salvation continuously. Great is the Lord. Let's pray.